I'm like a praying mantis, like a praying mantis. That song is good.
That was Don. That's Don Dixon.
Don Dixon.
Don Dixon with
praying. That song is good.
With praying mantis.
That's a really good song. I genuinely enjoy that.
No,
song.
I really like that song.
Yeah.
Welcome to Time of My Lifetime, the podcast where we watch old Lifetime movies and discuss them because they're amazing. I am Jordan.
And so you don't have to.
And I'm with my good friend Rocky.
Hi, America. How are you?
Our third host, Jules, is gone for the week, so it's just
she
us.
She is off being a boss.
That's fine.
Beautiful, independent woman.
I'll be honest. I feel a little weird doing this without her, especially.
I know it's weird.
Especially because I think she would have really enjoyed this movie.
I think she would have loved this movie.
This movie
was everything.
This was a good movie.
This movie was kind of like a Hall of Fame movie for me. I don't know about you.
Potential, yes. There were.
There were obvious problems with it, but there were wigs. Which I care about. There was an amazing pratfall with a cake.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. We're gonna make a gift.
I would say it would. If you're listening to this podcast, I think it would behoove you to watch this movie.
Absolutely.
And then listen, because there were just multiple parts, some visual parts that I think we're going to talk about that would really...
It would be hard to describe.
Right.
Like, verbally.
Like the cake scene.
Yeah, the cake.
Which I think we watched... Between watching it live and making the GIF of it, which will be up on our Tumblr page, I think we watched that cake scene at least 30 times.
30 times. I can't. Everyone put your hands together and let's walk a window. Blam! Okay. I'm sorry.
That was incredible. So, yes, I was saying...
the best thing that's ever happened.
I was saying, I think...
In a Lifetime movie ever.
So I'm sad Jules wasn't here to see that.
I know,
She'll be with us next time.
But, Jules is off. She's being a boss, and she's doing wonderful things. She's teaching the children.
And it's good.
And she will be back. And I know she will be missed.
And I'm sure she'll watch this movie after our discussion.
I hope she does. Well, so do you want to... Well, I don't know if you could tell from the song that we played at the beginning.
Oh, the movie is Praying Mantis.
It is called Praying Mantis, as in the insect.
You're like a praying mantis.
But it's from 1993.
Starring...
Jane Seymour, Dr. Quinn,
Dr.
Medicine Woman.
It's funny, because when we started the movie, I heard Jane Seymour, and for some reason I thought that was a Victoria's Secret supermodel from, like, the 90s.
I think it... What? Like,
Jane Seymour was not, though.
Stephanie Seymour. You're thinking of Stephanie Seymour.
That's who I'm thinking of.
November Rain video, where they're all, fake fling themselves across the table.
I'll be honest with you.
How does she die in the November Rain video? I never understood that.
Oh, I have no idea. I don't remember that.
It's like they all, the November Rain started, and then everyone was like, oh, it's raining, and then they were, running, and then people fake flinging themselves across, these...
Was it acid rain?
Like, folding tables.
Did it, maybe. I don't know.
And then the next scene...
It's a different song.
It's like Slash outside the church, then he's holding her body.
Wait, why are we talking about November Rain right now?
Because of Stephanie Seymour.
In any case,
I'm sorry. Anyway,
no.
But this
case,
movie stars
not
Jane Seymour,
Dr. Quinn, Medicine Woman.
Okay.
Which I realized after we started the movie.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So it's her and
Barry Bostwick,
who is
Rocky
now?
Horror Picture Show.
Okay.
He's Brad.
Okay. See, I don't know that guy.
Yes, you do. And the mayor on Spin City and. Other stuff.
Okay.
In
any case.
Anyway, he's a famous person.
Yeah.
So we start at... Well, Jane Seymour is in a church. It's a very elaborate wedding. She's wearing a very fancy gown with lots of detailing and beading and whatnot. And that weird sweetheart neckline. But like a turtleneck. But like... I guess it was a cutout across her boobs in the shape of a heart.
I don't know.
And that wig...
But the thing is, here's the thing about this movie is she's constantly wearing wigs. But as viewers, we can tell how obvious and bad the very wigs are. Wiggy. But well, I'm supposed to assume that the people she interacts with in the movie don't know that they're wigs?
Or maybe they know that it's a wig, but, like, they don't want to, like, ask, like, you know...
Because maybe...
Like, do you have alopecia?
Is it... Are you going through chemo?
Yeah, because that's, like, that's not...
Sure, but...
You know, sensitive.
Let's presume that it is something like that. She's marrying these guys.
Well, you would think that, yes, her fiancé would ask, why do you wear these plastic wigs?
Some sort of open
like,
lines?
Like, these cheap... Ass fucking plastic
communication.
Crazy wigs.
Yeah, right.
All, for the okay. whole movie. Like, you don't see Jane Seymour's real hair
and,
for the whole movie.
And her hair...
Unless, like, somebody... No, that's not her real hair.
Her hair never moves.
No, not once. Not once. There's no breeze that moves it. There is no... It's like... It's,
she does a number of violent things in this movie, and her hair
and she has,
never moves.
And she has sexual relations. She has all sorts of things. That would cause your hair to get fucked up. And it never once moves out of place.
No, it's crazy. It's crazy.
It's
crazy.
It's crazy.
So, let's just give a real quick synopsis.
Okay.
And then we'll talk about the further, like, the our favorite parts.
Okay,
I will
leave that in your
capable hands. Oh, okay. Well, so she's just a crazy woman. She marries people... She targets rich men, not
yes.
because she's extorting them, but because we don't really know why.
Right? Yeah, no, it's weird.
Like, we come to...
It's not, like, for their money.
No, it's not. We come to learn that she was probably abused when she was a kid.
Yeah, but she definitely has issues with her mother and her father.
She's got all... Oh, she's
all
got
sorts
all kinds
of issues.
But she marries... So she marries men.
Yes.
We know she's been married 5 times.
Mm-hmm.
And the movie
is about...
We see her
opening at her 5th wedding.
Right, and
yes.
So the course of the movie is really the 6th guy that she's courting
yes.
to kill. Because
she kills her 5th husband.
She kills the 5th one when the movie
right
starts.
After the wedding ceremony.
Right.
At the very beginning of the movie.
So, as the movie goes on, it's really just the story of her, like, courting and planning to murder the 6th guy.
Yes, Barry Bostwick. Yes.
Yeah, that's basically the whole movie.
That's basically the whole movie.
Except her plot gets foiled at the end from a nanny/aunt/sister-in-law.
I did not understand. They didn't say that she was the aunt until like 3/4 through the movie.
Well, they start calling her aunt.
Aunt Betty.
3/4 of the way through the movie.
She was just Betty, the housekeeper.
Right.
For the whole movie.
Well, but we knew that they had a weird... Her and the husband had a...
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure they had... I think like maybe like he and Betty like right after like his wife died... Like, maybe had, like, some sort of tryst that they just sort of never really talk about. But, like, why they were calling her the housekeeper when she's really the sister-in-law?
Yeah.
Until, like, 3/4 through the movie, and then they start calling her Aunt Betty.
Right.
Just all of a sudden.
It was...
No one ever called her... Like, Tommy did not...
It was confusing.
His son, Tommy...
Bobby.
Bobby. I'm sorry. Played by Chad Allen, who also was... Her Jane Seymour's adopted son on Dr. Quinn Medicine Woman.
I love that.
Or whatever. What was her relationship to those children on Dr. Quinn Medicine Woman? I don't remember.
I'm not going to lie to you. I haven't never seen a second of that
You
show.
Never watched Dr. Quinn Medicine Woman?
No, I'm familiar with it, but I never watched it.
Oh.
Was it as good as this movie?
No, but I will just say Sully, he was... He made me feel sensual when I was, like, 12 years old.
Okay.
Sully, well, her paramour.
What?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, so,
Wasn't that his name?
I have no idea.
I don't, the one with the long hair.
I don't have the
okay,
first
whatever.
Idea
it doesn't
what
matter. It
about.
Doesn't matter. All right.
But
so,
but so the her plot to kill the 6th husband gets
yes.
foiled by... This,
Aunt Betty.
By Aunt Betty.
And Bobby.
And Bobby, the son.
Mm-hmm.
And it ends... with her poisoning herself, because she's always poisons these guys,
right.
But it ends with her being caught, basically, and poisoning herself.
With cake.
With cake.
With wedding
with,
cake.
With poisoned wedding cake. The end. That's,
and she dies on the beach.
Yeah, she, in a very...
A very strange scene, but we'll get to that.
So, that's the... I mean, I think that's the gist of the movie.
Yeah, she's just sort of constantly changing her identity and putting on new wigs and marrying these men and poisoning them.
Right.
That's the movie.
That's... That is the movie. But there are... Okay, so...
And they're not even fabulous wigs. I'm sorry to go back. Okay.
No.
I'm sorry to go back to this, but, like, that wig that she had on at the beginning...
Terrible.
...was garbage.
Yeah.
It was, like, Party City for real.
Well, as we were watching it, we were like, that's obviously a wig. Mm. Wait, does her husband in this
exactly.
movie know? Like, he has to know.
He has
like,
to know that it's a wig.
But he, I don't think he does.
Hair doesn't look like that.
No, but I don't think he does know.
Maybe she's just marrying... Well, Barry Bostwick did seem very obtuse. Very obtuse.
What was his deal? So his wife...
His wife died.
Recently.
I think fairly recently.
Right?
It seems like it was fairly recent. And so... Aunt Betty, who we don't find out, is his dead wife's sister until, like, three-quarters of the way through the movie. Unless we weren't listening, because we were laughing too hard at the wigs.
I don't think so.
She lives with them. She's, like, the live-in housekeeper.
They call her the housekeeper.
They call her the housekeeper.
For the first two-thirds of the movie, they're, like, housekeeper.
Housekeeper Betty.
Not aunt, not sister-in-law.
But, like, she...
Live-in housekeeper.
But she functions as a surrogate mother to Bobby.
Right.
So, like...
Which makes more sense when we find out
that she's actually the aunt. Yeah.
Yeah.
But, like, at first it's like, oh, that's very strange. Like, oh, is this, like, is she, like, the nanny? Or is she, like... Well, anyway. But apparently she obviously has quite a crush on Barry Bostwick.
I don't know that she does, though. I thought she did when we thought that she was the housekeeper. I thought the relationship was very strange. I thought that...
No, but when she made the romantic dinner for him.
No, I don't think that. I don't think that was a romantic dinner, though.
What do you think? She was wearing, like, a slinky black dress and, like...
I know!
...lit two candles in the center of the table.
Watching it at the time...
And Bobby wasn't invited
to
the dinner.
No, Bobby was invited. He says it later, something about, like, why didn't you show up to dinner? Bobby was invited, so it was a odd romantic dinner.
Well, if Bobby was invited, why wasn't he at the table? When she was lighting the candles.
Oh, I don't know.
And why was she wearing that sexy va-va-va-voom dress with her ass and her titties and all of that hanging out?
Well, their relationship... Talk about blurred lines. That was...
Yeah. Can we not talk about Robin Thicke?
No, we won't talk about... But I'm just saying, they had a very...
Paula, please.
They had a...
Did you see the video for that song? Where he was like, he wrote... He did, like, a video... And, like, had, like, their real text messages back and forth.
Wait, are we talking about Barry
Robin?
Bostwick?
No, Robin Thicke and Paula Pounce.
Once again, I have no idea what you're talking about. We were just talking about Paula Poundstone?
Paula Patton, his wife, and Robin Thicke.
Oh, I know who that
is. Literally were just talking about
it. I remember
like,
that.
10 minutes before we started recording
this.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know that.
He made the album to get his wife back. Okay.
Right.
Yeah, so the video for the first single,
he
had, like, real text messages between the two of them, and he was like, I wrote a whole album for you, and she was like, I don't care.
Good for her.
I know.
Fuck that guy.
Fuck Robin Thicke. Anyway, back to the movie.
Yeah, fuck that guy.
That was my point. Fuck Robin Thicke.
Well...
I want some gummy bears.
Well, how did we get to that?
The dinner.
The dinner. That dinner.
So, well, let's go... We should go back, because I think we're probably getting a little bit ahead of ourselves.
Okay.
So, she kills the first husband, and it's actually kind of very important, because, like, they're having, like, a romantic moment in the hotel room. There was nobody at their wedding ceremony.
No one. Which isn't weird at all.
Which is so peculiar.
No, that's not weird. Hey, I love you. Let's get married. Don't invite anybody.
Don't invite a single fucking person
nope.
except for the pastor. Except, like, I don't even understand. It's like there wasn't even, like, a witness. It was just
the two of them and the pastor.
There
was literally zero people at the wedding.
And it was so elaborate. She was wearing, like, the most elaborate dress with the train and the beading and the embroidery and the lace and the...
Okay, so we've watched... I mean, we've only recorded two of these now, but...
we've recorded five of these. This is the second one we're releasing. Hi.
That's
weird. Here's how your sausage is made.
Okay, we've released two, but we've watched a bunch before we even had this idea.
Mm-hmm.
Is she the craziest woman that in any Lifetime movie that we've seen? She's insane.
She's pretty bonkers.
She's the praying mantis.
She's pretty bonkers. I'm trying to think. She's pretty bonkers.
Okay.
Well, Joanna Kearns in...
Yeah.
She was crazy.
Yeah, but this lady is... I mean, this... Dr. Quinn is... She's killed at least five husbands.
Five people. Well,
there's
anyway,
so much to discuss.
Yeah. Well, what I was saying was, like, so they go back to the hotel, like, the honeymoon suite, and then they're having, like, this romantic moment, and she's like, I got you this very, you know, expensive bottle of scotch or whatever the fuck it was, and he opens it, pours a glass, takes a sip, it's full of cyanide, immediately he's like, and like falls down, like, why did you do this to me? And her whole thing, apparently, is that...
What is her thing?
Well, what she says is, like, I had to do this to you right now, because, like, in the future, it's all gonna be, like, you know, fighting and cheating and anger and disappointment. So, like, we have to just keep this moment the way it is right now when it's perfect and we're in love. And I'm sorry to do this to you, but, you know... Well, she doesn't say I'm sorry.
What's her... So, what's... Because we don't ever learn for certain...
Well, that's, she just seems like that's her
pathology.
What's
her what's her motivation?
Well, I guess maybe she's just, like, a love junkie.
Why does she have to kill? So, okay.
Because, like...
It's like, because this isn't as good as it's ever going
to
be.
Exactly. It's all downhill from here. So I have to kill you right now while we're at the top of the hill.
But she's... she must have killed... Because in the course of the sixth guy...
Yes.
She kills...
She killed Aunt Betty.
She killed... Betty ends up dying.
Oh, slutty hostess. Who fuck that bitch.
That's the only time
that I'm on Dr. Quinn's side.
Slutty hostess. We'll get to that in a second.
No.
But she killed... So
no.
So she killed two...
Ooh, slutty hostess.
Wait, so she killed two people?
Slutty hostess fucking with me, no.
And
hell no.
And
she
killed two people and attempted to kill Bobby in the course of killing the sixth
guy. Is that
guy.
It? That's the only... Those are the only people she killed?
Well, but... And she also... killed her five previous husbands.
Well, right, but, like, I just meant...
In the course of the movie, in the course of
the... It was the only two?
Yeah, but two.
Oh,
but
it
you tried,
like it was so much
But you
more.
Tried to kill Bobby. So you assume... Let's assume that's her average number.
Right.
Two and a half murders per husband. Six husbands.
That's a lot of murders.
So she's killed over...
That's a lot
15
of
people.
That's a lot of murders.
That's a lot of murders. That's
yeah,
a
no,
lot.
Well, yeah, because she's a fucking psychopath.
Okay, so let's talk about slutty hostess who had it coming. So,
girl. So she moves to this new town. She, well, apparently she had researched Barry Bostwick.
Starts dating him.
Starts dating, goes to the bookstore that he owns. Is like, oh, I'm researching Russian literature. And he's like, oh, I find you very intriguing. And you're like, you know, Madeline Kahn from Clue, Mrs. White wig.
Very much Mrs. White.
She looked like Mrs. White.
Mrs. White wig, personality, everything.
Like this very, like, Louise Brooks 20s, like, you know, Salisha from America's Next Top Model. Like,
I don't know
after
any,
her makeover.
I don't know any of these references.
I know, you're straight, shut up.
I don't know any of them. Yeah, Salisha.
I think Salisha is probably a deep cut.
Bye, Felicia. Hey, Salisha.
Hey, Felicia. I don't know. I think the winner of America's Top Model, Cycle 11, or whatever the fuck it was, is probably a deep cut.
What?
I know. My brain is weird. I know.
Okay.
Just Marvel. Marvel.
So they're going to dinner. It's
yes.
Like, it's one of their first... It's one of their early
it's
dates.
It's like one of their, like... Well, it had to be, like, their third date, because it was after she met the family.
Well, as we learned,
the second
from, as we learned from Lifetime movies, always introduce your potential...
Your entire family.
The entire family to your second date. Always do that.
Yes.
I mean, what did you do for your second date? Oh, met my family.
I met the whole family.
We met the family.
And we had some Robichon.
We had some Robichon. We met the whole family. We had a nice big dinner. There was a reunion. I'm at the third cousins.
Callbacks to episodes we didn't release.
It's true. Well, anyway.
It's an inside joke between us and the universe.
But, so the third date then...
Yes, they go to this restaurant, like a seafood restaurant, and they walk in, and there's this slutty blonde girl.
Well, she's not, I mean, she's...
No, as soon as they walk in, this blonde girl in this, like, 80s power, not pantsuit, but, like, it's like a skirt suit.
Yeah,
I mean, she's like a peplum.
She's a hostess.
And, like, huge brass buttons down the front.
Hostess or owner, perhaps.
Or maybe she was the owner. She comes up to him, like, immediately and starts putting her hands on him.
She is,
like,
so friendly.
Like, so friendly. And
friendly's not the right word.
No. And, like, I forget what his name is in the movie.
Don.
That's not his name in the movie. That's the name of the dude who sang the song.
No, I think his name is Don.
Is it?
I believe so. Let's call him Don.
Fine, Don. So, so she walks up to Don. She starts putting her hands on his chest and rubbing his arms, and we're like, "Oh my god, Don! I haven't seen you in so long!" And like pushing her boobs out, and
she's
like throwing her head back,
she's
and
basically
shaking her hair.
She's basically jacking him off, like in front of
his date.
In front of the praying
Jane
mantis.
Seymour is standing right there.
Right there.
And it's like, you don't know what her relationship to him is. But whether she is his sister, whether she is his date, whether she is a business associate, whatever, this is not appropriate. And you are the hostess
so
of the restaurant.
Inappropriate.
And like when Jane Seymour tries to like bring it back
her,
a little bit.
I think we saw her cupping his balls in that scene. Like
I wouldn't be surprised.
Ridiculous.
Like, it was crazy. And then like Jane Seymour is like, Don, our table is ready. She's like, oh, Don, what was it, like 5 months ago, the last time I saw you? Oh, right, your table, let's go. And like with her hand on his shoulder. And then they sit down at the table and she's like, you all enjoy your meal. And then goes up behind him, puts her arms around his neck, gives him a kiss on the temple, and says, he's my favorite man.
He's my favorite man.
He is my favorite man.
That's exactly what she said.
He is my favorite man.
Okay, let me go seat somebody else now. Like, that was...
Excuse me, bitch?
Yeah, that was...
What did you say?
So later on...
He's
so...
your favorite. Who and the what?
So then some, like,
oh,
wine...
no, 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 no. We need to talk about slutty hostess a little bit more.
No, I am. So, then some, wait, so, hang on. So, like...
Well, I'm just saying that... I'm just... Okay, fine. I'm sorry.
Wait, oh, what?
No, I just think... I have no words for slutty hostess. She is so...
Her behavior is...
Her behavior is so unprofessional.
Ridiculous.
So disgusting. So, like, I hate it. This is the one instance in the movie where I'm just like, okay, Jane Seymour. That's
no,
nice.
No, slutty... Because,
like, I'm just saying, if that was my man, oh, hell to the no.
Yeah.
No, 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 no. That's not what we do. But then at the table, he's trying to
get... Would you...
No, I wouldn't murder her.
Would you murder her?
I wouldn't murder her.
Okay, because that's what Jane Seymour does.
No, but I would just be a bitch.
Okay. Because then, like...
Because, like, Jane Seymour's, like, a bitch to her, especially after she, like, pours liqueur on her blouse.
That seemed like an accident.
Yeah, no, it was totally an accident.
I mean, it was an accident. They meet in the bathroom. Jane Seymour's like, bitch, stay the fuck away.
And we're supposed to think that Jane Seymour is, like, unreasonable for that.
No.
I got the feeling, like, we as an audience were supposed to think that Jane Seymour was, like... She spilled liqueur on her blouse after she kissed her man while she's on a date with him.
Oh. Wait, so you think the audience was supposed to be on slutty hostesses?
No. Yes, yes.
What?
Because we're supposed to think that Jane Seymour... We know that Jane Seymour is a murderer and
yeah.
a psycho.
Oh, well...
We know that for a fact. We saw her murder someone at the beginning.
That behavior is never appropriate.
Exactly.
I mean, that was crazy.
Exactly.
Oh, my God.
No, slutty hostess.
So Jane Seymour...
I'm sorry, slutty hostess. You just have to go.
She got... I mean, she... Of everyone that dies in the movie is... Or we know has been murdered, slutty hostess... Sort of had it coming.
Slutty, that's right there in the name. Slutty hostess.
I think that's what she was credited as.
I don't think that's the case.
Slutty hostess? Like, some actress. No? That would be amazing, though.
The only thing, like, what was so weird about this movie, I feel like whenever we watch these sort of thrillers, like these lifetime thrillers. Like we get to see the psycho, like, you know, perpetrating the crime.
Yeah.
But this, in this case, we see her like stalking slutty hostess as she's closing up the restaurant mm-hmm. from her car. And then we just read about it in the newspaper the next day. Yeah. Like, oh, slutty hostess found murdered.
Yeah.
On Main Street.
That's actually what the headline said. Slutty hostess found murdered. Just in big capital letters. And like everyone in town knew who that was. It's like, oh, yep. Everyone's like, yep, she had it coming. Yeah. I mean, you wrap around your arms around one too many guys. Someone's gonna murder you.
There are a lot of like secondary characters in this movie that I feel like we can like people in this town. It's like a small town that she moves to where he owns a chain of bookstores.
Yeah,
but like the cashier at the bookstore and all of her outfits.
Oh, I wish. Yeah, we're gonna have to put pictures of.
We should put pictures of that. Of like her that cookie monster pelt.
Her cookie monster pelt was
amazing.
That was a good look.
It was amazing. Or when we first meet her and she's wearing like the sort of worn Jeff's wife FLDS,
yes.
like head to toe.
She looked like she had her hair up in that Mormon bun. The first scene she's in, she looks like she was just rescued off of like one of those like camps.
Mm-hmm. She looked like she was the 21st wife, like, for real.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Someone, when you see something like that, you have to sit back and be like, someone was responsible for dressing her that way.
There was a costume designer, costume coordinator.
Someone did that to you.
And a hair and makeup person.
Someone intentionally dressed you this way.
And then
way.
A director who was like, perfect. That's exactly what I'm going for.
Okay, I don't think we can go any further at all on this without talking about Betty's alcoholism.
Oh, Betty.
So Betty, who is the housekeeper / aunt / sister-in-law. I guess aunt
Betty.
And sister-in-law are the same thing. She's got an alcohol... How do we find out that she's got an alcohol
problem? Because... So when she and Dr. Quinn first meet, like, Barry Bostwick is
Was
like,
that their second date family dinner?
Yes, yes. Okay. It was, like, after they went grocery shopping and she saw the mom spanking her daughter.
Oh, right.
And, like, went up to the mom and was like, if I ever see you spanking her again, you will see me again.
Yeah.
And you will know.
And then
the mom was like, oh. And, like, I appreciated her, like, standing up for the child. But then, so, they went back to the house and then... Betty helped them bring the groceries.
At this point in the movie, we know Betty to be the housekeeper.
Yes. So it's like...
The housekeeper.
Yes, so it makes complete sense that she would help them bring the groceries in.
She should be buying the groceries. She's a live-in housekeeper.
Well, but this was a dinner that Dr. Quinn was preparing.
Okay, fine.
Yeah, so like, why would she...
I don't know.
For some reason, it was a recipe that required 6 fresh artichokes.
All of my experience with live-in housekeepers comes from, I think, 3 things. Who's the boss?
Mm-hmm.
Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, and that show from the 80s with the... not Facts of
Give
Life.
Give me a break.
Give me a break. Mm-hmm. That's everything I know about live-in housekeepers. I didn't even know this was a thing. I thought a live-in housekeeper was Tony Danza doing like a bad Southern impression.
Well, oh, no. I mean, I have lots of, you know, obviously my job. I have lots of wealthy clients who have live-in housekeepers. And then when I was a kid, I had a friend who had a live-in housekeeper. She was the nicest one. She just passed away,
a month ago. I thought it was a made-up thing.
So rest in peace to you, too.
So this is now my 4th experience with a live-in... Betty. And Betty... Do you want your live-in housekeeper to be a raging drunk?
Well, she was keeping it together at first, because, like, she was, like... So they, like, had, like, their... Like, they were chit-chatting the first time that they met, and, what's her name? Dr. Quinn's sort of con is that she's a romance novelist.
Mm-hmm.
And so, and she's researching like 19th century Russian history because she's writing a book about a czar and the farm girl.
Which is bullshit because she's not even right. Right. It's her.
And then Betty is like, oh, I loved Anna Karenina. And Dr. Quinn's like, oh my God, I loved her work too.
Yeah, she's my favorite author.
Like, no.
Yeah.
No, bitch. So, like, Betty was like, And so they have dinner, and like, Dr. Quinn's like, oh, Betty, you must have some wine. It's delicious. And Betty's like, oh, no, 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 thank you. And she's like, oh, but I don't want all this wine to go to waste. And she's like, I said no. And it's like, oh.
Yeah, she's
just
on,
like,
she's,
Betty's clearly just, like, white-knuckling it at the table.
She's on the wagon.
Yeah, she's on the wagon.
You know?
And then that shady fucking shit, Dr. Quinn, because she made Cherry's Jubilee, and, you know, you set it on fire. Mm-hmm. And then, like, what's her name? Betty was like, oh no, I shouldn't.
What did she shoot? She's goes, like, all the alcohol will burn
all
up.
All the alcohol burns off, Betty. Oh. And then he takes it with a spoon, and she's just like,
and then there's several other scenes where Betty's drinking. We know Betty.
Yes.
Betty. And I'm not judging.
No, no.
But
no,
Betty,
because
Betty
knows. Betty knows that this is some bullshit.
And Betty,
and she's in love with Barry. I think she's in love with Barry Bostwick.
I think
Bostwick.
She is, too.
And she loves her nephew.
But Betty...
Certainly.
Betty is such a tragic character in this movie.
So, I can't...
Because,
Betty...
Well, first of all...
I can't.
There is this scene, the engagement party. They have an engagement party. And... Betty has maybe one too many drinks.
Well, before that, with the dinner.
Yeah, well, right, but we know Betty likes the bottle. So, yeah. but there's the dinner.
Well, I think the thing that set her off, her drinking, was the dinner, because she prepared this dinner for him. She called the store and left a message with the cashier that was like, tell him that I'm making a very special dinner at 8 o'clock. I won't take no for an answer. And of course, Dr. Quinn was standing right there. Threw the message away.
Yeah.
And was like, come have dinner with me.
And
that's when we met Slutty Hostess.
How do people live without cell phones?
I don't know.
Just text. Just text it. I'm making dinner.
I won't take no for an answer.
I won't take no for an answer. But no, in 1993...
And then you could even, like, sext him, like, this is the dress I'm wearing.
Right.
Hello.
But in 1993, you literally have to put a Post-it note on a computer screen
right?
That anyone can...
Rip off.
It could just fall... It's a Post-it note. It could just fall
off.
Yeah,
and then, like, the cashier was like, oh, no, I wrote the message. I don't know what happened to it. And, like, Betty's like, oh, it just got legs and it walked away. And it's like... She put a Post-it on a computer screen. Any number of things could have happened
So many things could have happened.
But
anyway,
at the engagement dinner,
after
their drinking has started, so...
Betty is just
Betty,
like...
Betty's off the wagon now at this point.
She is wilding out.
And, you know, Betty's alcoholism in this movie really, to me, was a subplot, I think. Because she's... No one believes her. You know, she discovers everything. She discovers everything about two-thirds of the way through the movie. She knows exactly what's going on. She's watching. Mm-hmm. She's watching
Armed and Dangerous. Like America's Most Wanted.
I thought it was like a hard copy.
Oh yeah, it was more like a hard Current Affair.
Yeah,
or
Current
copy.
Affair.
Yeah.
But she's watching a show like that. And she's like, oh my god, it's her. It's the bride that kills all of her husbands. Mm-hmm. But
what was
like
her name? The marriage. Marriage Mantis.
Marriage Mantis? The praying marriage mantis?
I don't know. My perspicacity is not working at the moment.
My perspicacity as well is very off. the bride.
The murdering bride.
The murdering bride.
The deadly.
The bludgeoning. The bludgeoning bride.
The bludgeon or
the poisoning.
Lady. The poison lady.
The poison lady.
Just the poison lady.
Don't drink her wine.
Oh my god, it's the poison lady. She's coming.
So,
she's offering me a drink.
So at the engagement party, again, Betty's had one too many drinks, and
yeah.
she literally falls on... She brings the cake out.
You guys.
And this is
you guys, like, we made a GIF. And we're gonna put it on our. But like seriously, this is one of the reasons why I'm like, you need to watch this.
You have to watch this movie, if only for this.
If only
scene.
For that scene, because I have not laughed that hard, and I feel terrible because I know
that poor actress.
Oh, Frances Fisher from Titanic, by the way. She, ex-husband or ex-wife of Clint Eastwood.
She's carrying a tray that has the cake on it. She's had too many to drink. She takes a stumble and falls face first into the edge of the tray.
Her forehead bounces off the edge of the tray. And it's the most astounding. Like, how she didn't get a concussion.
No, she must
from
have.
I mean, they must have had her do, like, 30 takes. Oh, they, and they just picked the most painful looking
they
one.
Had to. They must have had to have filed so much paperwork and workmen's compensation claims from that scene.
Like, I mean, but, like, everything about it, like her whole, like, monologue as she's holding the cake, and she's like, hey, Belle, it's pretty handy in the kitchen, but I guess it's pretty handy in other places. Like, everybody puts your hands together for Lindsay. Boom! It's just like, what did she trip over? Just like her drunk ankles? Like she just rolled her drunk ankle in like her heels.
She had too much punch at the engagement party.
Oh, and somebody was like, oh, that punch is lethal. And like you see like Betty like hears them say that, and she like looks at it and she's like, ooh, glug 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 glug. Like,
well, this is what I'm saying. Betty, she's such a tragic figure, because then, you know, afterwards everyone knows that Aunt Betty, or whatever, the housekeeper, whatever you want to call her, everyone knows she's a drunk. Mm. She figures it out about this lady, and no one wants to,
because she watches the current
event. No one wants to believe her, mm-hmm. because it's always prefaced with, oh, you can't really trust anything Betty says.
But
you know how much she likes to drink.
But then she sneaks into the house and goes through Dr. Quinn's things, finds the wedding rings from the five dead husbands, and all the research that she did on Barry Bostwick, and takes them
right
out of the house.
Well, no, that's the whole thing that makes it even crazier, is because she's got the evidence.
But
the husband doesn't listen to her, the son doesn't listen to her. She's got the evidence, but they're just like, Betty's a drunk, you can't really listen
to her.
But
see, the problem is that, like, and here's what, like, Betty's decision-making, obviously, is just specious.
Questionable.
Throughout. Because, like, A, just the fact that, like, this weird living situation you have with your dead sister's husband, and, like, cooking him romantic dinners
unhealthy.
And wearing your freakum dresses
unhealthy.
While you wait for him and cry. You don't blow out the candles before you go to bed. That's weird.
Dangerous.
She was probably too drunk.
Probably.
Anyway,
I was hoping they were going to like pan over, and she was just going to be like splayed out
on the couch.
Floor, just like.
But my point is, when she gets all of the evidence, she gets the rings, she gets all the research, she gets all the things. The person that she goes to is not the police or the two bumbling FBI agents who are on the case.
But she goes to the hard copy ripoff?
Well, she calls them, we find out later.
Yeah,
she goes to his son. Yeah, she goes to his son. Who likes Linda, Dr. Quinn.
Yes.
Who has a bond with her. And goes to him after, like, 12 mimosas that we see her drink, which, I mean,
hey,
I'm not gonna judge.
Who hasn't been to brunch before?
I had a 12 mimosa brunch. We both had a 12 mimosa brunch just a few days ago. I'm not judging her for that.
No, I'm not judging her for that at all.
But I'm just saying, she was not in the right mind to be giving evidence to this teenage boy.
No.
And she doesn't even really explain herself well. She's just like, I saw current affair, she was wearing the same ring, and then I found the wedding rings in the box, and then I found the papers. And
so,
like, so yeah, Bobby's like, what the fuck are you talking about?
So do you think one of the morals of this movie is that, like, you should sometimes trust what drunk people have to say?
Well,
like, is that a moral?
Well,
because everyone disregards her, and she ends up being murdered by Dr. Quinn.
Well, but I think we listen to, like, drunk men all the time, you know, like.
And
I think it had to do with her being drunk and a woman.
Oh.
People were, like, discounting her, like, oh, you're just jealous.
Well, that's why I thought, you know, on these Lifetime movies, you're always looking for the strong, like, woman.
Mm-hmm.
In this movie, Jane Seymour's not the strong woman; she's obviously the bad guy.
Can we just talk about Jane's... Well, are we done talking about Betty yet?
Yeah, sure.
Well, basically, like,
yeah,
Betty...
No, that's fine.
No, we'll finish it up. Like, Betty's just so tragic.
And she gets murdered.
And she gets murdered by Dr. Quinn. And which, in a murder that makes no fucking sense, because, like...
But the cops figure that out later on.
Yes, they do. But, like, I'm just saying, no, like, in Dr. Quinn's head,
Dr. Quinn's
it made
crazy
no
brain.
Sense. Because, like, she was, like, so
she
shows up
hammer?
At her apartment, hits her in the head with a hammer.
Puts her in the bathtub.
And then slits her wrists afterwards.
Right. You would think even a crazy deranged person like her would know that at some point a coroner is going to be like, oh yeah, she slit her wrists. Hey, wait a second. Her brain is caved in.
But see, like, that's
right?
Yeah. Like, there's clearly blunt force trauma. It like, looks like a hammer.
I'm not a coroner, but I'm pretty sure I can figure that one out. Yeah.
But, like, see, that's just is what I wanted to talk about, though, with Dr. Quinn. Because it's, like, I feel like in, like, all of these, like, you know, these movies, and, like, even on, like, you know, like, CSI and Criminal Minds and, like, those kinds of procedural shows or whatever, it's, like, you know, the villain... The murderer, serial killer, or whatever, is also always, like, the sociopath, but he's always, like, or she is always, like, one step ahead of the cops or whatever. Dr. Quinn, in this movie, she's dumb.
Yeah,
she's
I thought that, too.
Dumb.
I thought that, too.
Like, she's not good at crime. Yes, she's, like, killed these five men, and she hasn't been caught yet.
How? How has she not been caught yet?
It just seems like her MO is so... It's just because she puts on a different wig and goes to a different town?
Apparently
That's the only thing that it takes. And not to say that, like... I mean, as dumb as Dr. Quinn is, those FBI agents are, like, 10,000 times dumber than her.
They're not so good.
They're not good at their jobs.
They're not so good at their
None of them are good at their jobs. No one in law enforcement in this movie is good at their job.
That's another theme, I think, from Lifetime movies
yes.
in general, though.
Don't trust the detective
no.
that has been assigned
no.
to your case.
No, you better solve that crime yourself,
mm-hmm.
because the detectives are
mm-mm.
not gonna... It's like,
No, it's always some lame, fat, white dude that's like...
With a great head of hair.
With a great head of hair.
It's always some lame, fat, white guy with a great head of hair. And maybe a chiseled chin.
Maybe.
Oh,
like that one that we watch with, It's fine.
Okay.
With what's his name? From Felicity, Sean.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, God, he was the worst. Anyway, but these FBI agents are terrible. But, like what I don't understand is that, like, from jump, like, with her relationship with Barry Bostwick, she is demonstratively crazy.
Yes.
Like, anyone, I don't care who you are, gay, straight, white, black, male, female, everything in between.
Purple.
If you were dating this person, you would be like, after the first date.
Out. Dunzo.
Done.
Crazy.
Done.
It's just got crazy eyes.
Like, after their second date.
She's obviously wearing a crazy wig.
Like a crazy wig. Like a crazy obvious. I can't stop with her wig.
Like, yeah, after the second date,
like, she takes him to her house, and...
Has a breakdown of sorts, right?
Well, first she's like, I'm gonna go upstairs and slip into something a little more comfortable. And he's like, oh, yeah, and he, like, pours himself, like, the tiniest drink, like, just a little nip.
Just a little bit.
Like, little
just
nip
a
of scotch.
Bit.
And then, like, goes over to her typewriter where her one-page manuscript
right.
is sitting. And then she's like, you weren't supposed to read that. And you think he's going to turn around, and they're going to cut to her and, like, some, like, fabulous lingerie.
No.
And, like, garters. And no, that bitch is wearing sweatpants.
Okay.
And he was like, oh, when you said you were going to wear something more comfortable, I didn't think you meant
okay.
literally.
In my experience,
yes.
if I'm somewhere with a woman and she tells me she's going to slip into something more comfortable, I'm full on expecting her to come out in like a sweatshirt and sweatpants. That's just from my experience.
Well, right, but I'm just saying,
like, I'd be like, oh, all right, cool. I'm going to, you know, take my shoes off. Like, all
but
right.
this is like, but you're talking about real life. The movie cliche, let me go upstairs and put on a little something more comfortable. Means I'm going to go put on something very uncomfortable and complicated.
Well, that's what I'm saying. That's what I'd be like, straight up, you're wearing sweatpants now? Yeah, alright, right on.
But, has anyone ever said to you, Jordan, I'm going to put on something a little more comfortable and played with your chest with their fingers and run their fingers through your hair and like, bye big boy, I'll be right back, and all of those sorts of things.
No,
she's clearly flirting with him touching him rubbing his arm and his chest giving him flirty eyes, I'm gonna put on something more comfortable.
But they spend the rest of the night, this is why you should break up with her immediately, right? Because they spend the rest of the night not banging.
Well, they first start making out.
Yeah.
And then she's like, stop it, stop it, you're scaring me.
Freaks out. And just, they spend the night just her crying.
Which is fine. And he's totally cool about it. She's
very nice.
She's like, I'm not ready. And he's like, you know what, I'm not ready either.
Yeah, great.
So let's just, table this. And that's when I would be like, okay, I'm going to go home.
Yeah.
But instead, she just demands that he stay and hold her while she freaks out and cries.
Right. So, see, if that's my second date with a girl, there's not going to be a third one. You've got some... I'm not saying you're a bad person. In this case, James Seymour, you're a bad person. I'm not saying you're a bad person, but you clearly have some issues.
You have some stuff.
You need to handle... before you're ready to be out there. And he doesn't...
And he never asks her anything about her.
No.
He never asks her anything about her past. He never asks her anything about past relationships. Just a little bit of, a little snippet about, her father.
Very little.
Very little. He's very just sort of, she's just sort of, this need-fulfilling object to him. She's not a person. She's not... she's just sort of this sexy woman in a wig or whatever. So it's I guess he's just sort of not the type of person, like a typical Lifetime movie dude, who's not seeing her as an actual person, but just as a thing that he's trying to put his penis into at some point.
Yeah.
And that's why the whole marriage, just all of a sudden...
They get married very quickly.
3 weeks after they know each other, all of a sudden he just, tells his son, who just lost his mom, oh yeah, we're getting married tomorrow.
Tomorrow. Immediately. Be there or be square.
What the fuck?
That's another...
He's actually kind of a terrible person.
He's a bad dad.
He's a terrible father.
I think that's another...
And he's not very good at... He's not a very good partner. Well, I think that's either. Another... at how he treated Betty.
Not well.
He did not treat Betty nicely.
Well, I think this is another lesson that I get from Lifetime movies, which is that you shouldn't marry somebody after only knowing them for a couple of weeks.
No, I think that's a bad idea.
Because every time you do that...
I think that's a bad
idea. Things just kind of go wrong.
They really fall apart.
You think you would really get to know someone after a good 10 to 15 days, but on day 16, you find out, wait, she killed her last 5 husbands. Maybe this wasn't such a good idea.
And also, I think it's just, it's a bad sign when you go up to the cabin to plan the wedding or whatever, and you have your new wife meet you while you're literally standing on the grave of your dead wife.
Wait. That was the grave of his dead wife?
That's what I'm assuming. Why else would he be talking to a headstone in the graveyard before she walked up?
Wait, he was talking to the headstone?
Yes!
Wait, what?
Yes, and... But even regardless, even if it wasn't his dead wife, why... A graveyard? Why are they meeting in a graveyard and standing on a grave?
It was very disrespectful to whoever that
right was. Before they go into their wedding ceremony.
Oh, boy. I want to get close to wrapping this up because we're getting close to time. But can we talk about the son for a minute? Because yes, I really absolutely liked Bobby.
I like Bobby. I love Chad Allen. He is a strong proponent of gay rights.
See, I don't know him. Here's what I know about Bobby from this movie. A, apparently he's 5'4".
He's very tiny.
Because he's the same height as Jane Seymour.
In heels.
And Barry Bostwick, or Don, or whatever. Uh-huh. he must be like 6'5" because there's
giant.
There's one shot of the three of them, and Bobby and Jane Seymour are like on the same level. She might even be like an inch taller than him. And then the Don is just like towering over him. So there's that. So I love that about him. But I also loved he reminded me of like I thought he looked like a young Joaquin Phoenix. Mm-hmm. But he also had like this whole just kind of like. Whatever, guys. Like attitude. He was very like.
Whatever, dad.
It was very like Keanu Reeves in any movie, but Point Break specifically. It was very.
Oh,
like,
your favorite movie.
It was very.
Oh, you love Bobby.
I like his like. Whatever. I'm just gonna catch some waves, dad. Like it's cool. I don't care that mom is dead. Marry her. She's cool. I like her. So I like Bobby. In fact, I think I accidentally just segued into favorite characters.
Oh.
Sorry.
No.
He's my favorite character.
He is your favorite character?
He's great.
I like Bobby. His hair was questionable, but I did like all of his various windbreakers in fun colors.
Oh, so many windbreakers and tracksuits in this
movie. So many. Oh, yeah. My God. So, I mean, the fashion in this movie is bonkers.
For that alone, I think anyone should... watch this.
The fashions in this movie, like, we already talked about the cashier, but, like, Dr. Quinn, like, that dress she's wearing at the engagement party, with, like, it's a turtleneck in the front and backless in the back.
Turtleneck and backless. Why did that ever go out of style?
How did the physics of that work, though?
Very, very strong neck muscles.
But she's working it, And then Betty and her whole succession of, like, freakum dresses that they go on. All the sweaters, so many chunky turtleneck sweaters.
Yes.
And turtleneck sweater dresses.
Yeah.
Like,
again.
Just beautiful.
Why did that go out of fashion?
I don't know. They look warm.
Well, you know, I've been told that the 90s are back.
Like
so...
when she was wearing that salmon turtleneck
dress.
It was amazing.
So do you have a favorite, do you have a favorite character?
I'm going to go with Betty.
Oh, tragic Betty.
I'm going to go... Betty really just... She had my heart.
Betty?
She really did.
She's like Shakespearean.
Exactly. She is.
Right?
She just is.
Tragic.
She's like Ophelia or something. Like, she's in love with the wrong man. And, I mean, Ophelia, like, flung herself into a river, but she sort of...
Betty flung herself
into a metaphorical
river. Yes.
Which happened to be a bathtub into which she was flung by Dr. Quinn.
Close enough,
you know, it's kind of the same thing.
It's almost exactly the same. Okay.
Or, well, I guess maybe she was more like Desdemona, I guess.
Wow,
like she was...
now you're over my head.
Oh, Othello.
Yeah, I know Ophelia.
That's Hamlet.
I know.
I said Desdemona.
I know. Now you're over my head.
Othello.
I've.
You never read Othello?
I've heard of that. Iago.
Mm-hmm.
Othello.
Right.
There's a black guy.
Othello.
Yep. That's basically my knowledge.
Anyway, but Betty. I think she just tried so hard. You know,
she did,
but she just couldn't, and she loved Bobby, and she loved Don, she loved them so much, she just couldn't conquer her own demons in order to, like, help them the way that she wanted to, and she died really trying to help them, and, you know, I just felt for her.
Another moral, or,
Yes, what did we learn from this movie? What do you think? What did you learn?
Well, no one's going to take you seriously if you're a drunk. Even if,
then we better shut up and not do this podcast anymore.
That's what my takeaway.
Is that why no one listens to this?
Because they need to be drunker? Or because we need to be drunker?
Because I've had several glasses of wine at this point.
Yeah, but that's the point.
Right.
Yeah, it's fine.
Okay, well, anyway. I learned that there is a reason why drag queens fight over those wigs. because her wigs were
a good wig. A good.
I was aghast.
A good wig.
I was aghast.
A good wig is hard to find.
I was aghast.
A good wig.
The first second of the movie when the close up of her at that wedding in that church with that plastic palm tree looking blonde bullshit on her head. It was like if she was anywhere near a flame, it would have melted to her. She would have looked like a Lego person.
She did look like a Lego person.
She looked like a Lego person.
She did. Not a good look.
Not a good look.
So, just to wrap things up, I think we would agree this movie is super duper watchable.
It's really, really.
I'm not ready to put this in the Hall of Fame yet.
Well, on a scale of 1 to Joanna Kearns,
I would give this, I would give this 4/5 of a Joanna Kearns.
Yeah, because nothing could be like a full Joanna Kearns.
Unless Joanna Kearns is in it, it is not a full Joanna Kearns.
I would give it like 5/6
of Joanna Kearns. That's still pretty good.
It's very good. That's better than my rating. No, it's a vast majority.
Wow. All right. Once again, that was Praying Mantis.
1993.
Jane Seymour. We have a link up to it on our page, Time of My Lifetime Cast. Tumblr.com.
Just Time of My Lifetime.
Time of My Lifetime.
Tumblr.com.
We're also going to put up a GIF file of. GIF.
That's a GIF.
Okay. We're going to put up a quick file of.
That's gross. You say GIF?
I don't know. It's going to be the. It's worth 5 seconds of your time.
It's
worth 25 seconds of your time to watch it 5 times.
You did a really good job at that.
I think so.
You did a really
good job. I think it's pretty good.
You get a pat on the back.
All right. So, once again, thanks for listening to Time of My Lifetime. I once with my good friend Rocky.
Hi.
And once again, I'm Jordan. Hopefully, Jules is back with us next time because.
What's up with this whole thing where we're not saying our last names? You remember Jules? Like, she sent us that text and she was like, I don't like that we said our last name.
Yeah, I don't want to say my last name.
Well, should we make that last name for?
No.
Yeah, I think we should. I'm Rocky Lacroix.
I'm Jordan Kearns.
And, boom. Gotcha. I like that.
Thanks for listening to Time of My Lifetime.
Hopefully. Until next time of my lifetime.
Thank you. Good night.
Bye, America.